chance to join in as well they might. Obviously, we've held regular workshops on all variety of topics, from the finances to the democratic government. We've had lots of informal meetings. I hope that they will continue with the next period of council. But as I say, it is basically to thank you all. And for those who are standing down this time, I hope the community recognises all the hard work that you have put in over the years. For those who are going to stand again, very good luck. And I can only hope that we get a good field in May standing for election. That's all I have to say for that. We have an urgent item, which is the annual Treasury Management Strategy 2017-2018. I'll hand over to, I hope, Andy Brown.
Good morning. Yes. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Everyone's
okay.
Saying, yes.
I'll crack on then. So the annual Treasury Management Strategy 2017-18 is a statutory report that has to come to the council, and it sets out the Treasury strategy for the next financial year. It includes the annual investment strategy and the prudential indicators and something called the MRP policy, which is the minimum revenue provision policy, all of which are set out in Appendix 1 to the report. Hopefully that everyone has had an opportunity to read the reports. It's one of these quirks in local government where it's quite technical in its nature, but it is a statutory function that we have to set out certain indicators within the council in terms of our operation of our treasury management throughout the financial year, and that is detailed, as I say, in Appendix 1. There's a few issues that I think that needs bringing attention to the council, and that's clearly around our current cash position and current treasury position, and members will see under Section 3 of the report, which is on page 4, the current treasury position of the council. As mentioned previously, we were intending to go out and borrow temporarily to ensure that there was enough cash surplus. It's not unusual for councils to go out and temporarily borrow to cover cash flow, and that's exactly what the Council of the Isles of Scilly have done. There's details there in terms of the temporary loan that we have taken out, which was from Middlesbrough Council. A £2 million temporary loan has been taken out for around 2 months, and you can see the cost of that, which is very reasonable. It's only £1,000 in terms of the interest that we're going to incur, which will tide us over to meet our commitments until the new financial year, when government grant, council tax and business rates receipts will come back in, and we will return to a cash surplus position. The other critical issue to raise with members is around our debt position. And if I could just move you to the Appendix 1, and it is under page 11, section 3.1, which is our borrowing position against something that's known as the capital financing requirement. And effectively, as I say, this is the technical aspect of it. And the capital financing requirement is effectively the council's historic underlying borrowing position. Now, that calculation, the capital finance requirement, is saying that historically the council should have debt of around £5 million. And you can see that within the table on page 11 under 3.1. The actual borrowing position, the opening debt and the closing debt expected over the next 3 or 4 years, which is on the basis that we don't go out and borrow long term, we are effectively in a under-borrowed position of around £5 million. And now that is retrospective of a position whereby the council said it was going to borrow, but it actually hasn't undertaken long-term borrowing, which is some of the reasons that we talked about in the last council meeting of the rationale for our current cash position, whereby clearly, historically we should have gone out and borrowed. That is replicated in our capital financing requirement. The actual debt for the authority is minimal. We're effectively debt-free, and therefore we're in a under-borrowed position of about £5 million. At the moment, we are not, in this Treasury strategy, planning to long-term borrow, but as I've said in there, that we will look at that position where we assess the current need and the current cash position, we will then undertake borrowing within our authorised and approved limits. And that brings me on to the next position, which is on page 12, which is the limits for borrowing going forward. So last council I had to request for those limits to be increased to allow the temporary borrowing to be undertaken. On page 12, it details the revised limits going forward for 17-18. And you can see that the operational boundary is going to be set at £3.5 million. That is effectively therefore delegating the authority to me to undertake borrowing to ensure the treasury management and cash position for the council is sound. And that's up to a limit of £3.5 million. And then there's an authorised limit, which is the limit that we cannot breach without notifying Whitehall and indeed full council of £3.75 million. So those are the couple of the critical elements within the paper. I appreciate it is a technical paper, and it goes into quite a lot of detail in terms of setting our strategy for the next year, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Well, first I'd just like to thank Andy for the clarity of this paper. It's quite a complicated thing to get to grapple with, and I found it, I'd say, approaching interesting, which is quite novel for finance papers. But Councillor Gottick.
Yes, I'd also like to add that I find the narrative that Mr. Brown has given us extremely useful and easy to comprehend, so thank you. May I make Mr. Brown two comments? Firstly, that I very much appreciate, on behalf of the new council, page 8, 1.4, which suggests that as soon as anyone is elected to a council seat, they receive, as soon as possible, financial training. And I think this is absolutely to be commended. It is quite daunting getting finance papers as a new member, and I think this is extremely helpful. And it's not to say we haven't had any financial training, but I think for the new councillors to have it as soon as they sit in their seat almost is extremely worthwhile. So thank you for that. Can I also add one more general comment? That since any capital programme has revenue implications, would you support recommending to the new council that the capital programme agreed last April was subject to a formal review? I believe you did indicate in a workshop that you thought this would be a good idea, and I would like to see this minuted if it is indeed your continued considered opinion.
Yeah, I'm more than happy for that to be minuted and added as a recommendation. I think that is prudent in terms of reviewing the capital programme going forward. You will see the capital programme is on today's agenda to be approved. That is obviously very much the existing capital programme as previously approved. But so I'd welcome the recommendation and to review the capital programme in terms of its overall affordability, particularly, as Councillor Grotty points out, the revenue contributions and indeed the borrowing, the planned future borrowing, which is not significant, but certainly that should be reviewed in light of the financial circumstances facing the authority.
Are there any other comments? Oh, Councillor Saville.
Just for clarification, therefore, Chairman, are we now saying that we will not be able to approve a capital programme today going forward for the next few years? Because I would be very hesitant to do that. I think capital investment is important, and I think with the new framework that has been agreed by Council and the business cases will come at points within that framework to members to approve and obviously to the corporate leadership team. So, Chairman, can I just have clarification where the capital programme that is coming before us stands now?
Yes, you do come in.
If I can cover that off, Chairman, the capital programme that's put forward to you today is asked to be approved. I'm quite happy for the capital programme to be approved as set out in today's agenda. I think what I'm agreeing with Councillor Grotic is that we put a recommendation to review the capital programme in the new administration, which I think is prudent. We should always review the capital programme in terms of when it's been approved, as good practice to say, are these the projects that we are happy to still proceed with and to fund in that manner. So today, yes, it's being approved as it's been set out, and I think that's fine, and I'm happy for that to be approved. But as in line with good practice, it doesn't stop us, which is what the recommendation I think Councillor Grotic is asking for today, is that we review the capital programme as it's been approved in the next financial year following the elections.
Are there any other comments? Councillor Mawson.
Just one comment to Mr. Brown is that on a feel factor, I am very anti-borrowing of any description, and I've made those feelings clear. I really understand the situation where we are in at the moment with the authorised borrowings around about 5 million, but I'd just like reassurance that we're not going to be borrowing money to have in our reserves sat there doing nothing. That we are only going to borrow when we actually need it.
Yep, so in terms of the borrowing position, we're not going to borrow. Sorry, there's a bit of feedback. Put the microphone on. Thank you. That's better. So just to answer the question in terms of borrowing, forefront of my mind is a historical position where we should have borrowed, and therefore we're in an under-borrowed position in terms of our historic position, as I pointed out when introducing the report on page 11. So I'm mindful of that, and we have to correlate that to our cash flow position. As you'll know, when we took the statement of accounts for signing in the last council meeting, the section 24 notice issued by the auditor asked us to do a 14-month cash flow. So as we are finishing that, we have to have mindful in terms of our cash flow position, ensure that we have sufficient cash and manage that position well. However, to give the assurance, we aren't simply just going to borrow to secure that position. It will be we have to be mindful of the fact that when we do go out and borrow, that there will be a cost to it, and that's going to be have to be mapped out in the current financial position of the authority. So we can't just simply go out and borrow because with that borrowing has to be financed, and that has to be played out and balanced out in terms of the current financial position. So there's a lot of equations going on here in terms of the historic position that we should have borrowed and we haven't. So that needs to be rectified. We have to look at our cash flow position in terms of managing our day-to-day cash levels, and we have to then look at the affordability of going out to borrow, primarily to redress the historic position, but we have to then be mindful about the affordability of that going forward in the future. So there's not going to be a sudden rush out to go and borrow. I've set out in the Treasury Management Strategy that the intention is to hold the line, but then the pressing need will be around our cash flow position.
Thank you for that reassurance.
Councillor McCarthy?
Yes, my point was similar to the one that the councillor has just raised on borrowing, and I think Mr. Brown has clarified the position about borrowing. Under-borrowing sort of kind of sounds good, but in our circumstances, we perhaps actually, while interest rates were so low, might well have been better to have borrowed some. The difficulty now is that inflation is beginning to rise. I think I heard this morning that it's, you know, getting up towards 3%, and we therefore will need to be careful about how much we borrow, although the principle of borrowing is, you know, can be sensible if we don't want to damage our reserves too much.
Yes, I agree, and I think it's probably worth pointing out that I think we spent £1.5 million of our own money on the roads, whilst the council had a I think, total borrowing of £74,000, which is quite low for a lot of households now, let alone a local authority. Are there any other comments? Chris? Councillor Savile? Or indeed, Councillor Hicks?
I'd like to know how long you would expect the borrowing to last. How long would we need to have the loan for?
I think we've got 50 years in there, and also April next year for the two different types. But I'm sure Mr. Brown will fill you in a little.
Yeah, so in terms of, let's take that in two parts. Temporary borrowing will only ever be less than 12 months, hence by its definition, temporary short-term borrowing. So, for example, the £2 million that we've borrowed from Middlesbrough Council, that is only for 2 months, and that is only really to justify the forecast position that the cash surpluses would go to levels that we wouldn't be comfortable with, and therefore manages that cash position as at the end of this financial year. Long-term borrowing is a different factor, and if I can take you to page 12, which is on Appendix 1, there's the prospects for interest rates going forward. And you can see that the forecast for the Bank of England base rate is to hover around the 0.25% for about 2 years, and then only slightly begin to creep up. But you've also got the years broken down between 5 years, 10 years, 25 years and 50 years of longer term borrowing from effectively the government. PWLB, Public Works Loan Board, is an agency of the government, and that's where we would more than likely source our long-term borrowing from. So it's a matter of, in terms of matching our borrowing to principally the assets that we've funded through that borrowing. So, for example, if we have built or maintained roads, they generally have a longer life, asset life, and so therefore we'd be comfortable in terms of going out for a longer-term borrowing. But again, it's judgment call at the time. There are favourable rates down at the 10-year mark compared to the 25 or 50-year. But generally, you align your borrowing, your length of your borrowing to your length of your assets, and that would be a judgment call in line with what the rates are doing at the time when we come to borrow long-term.
Thank you.
Councillor Savile first.
I was going to just propose the recommendations, including the one that Councillor Mrs. Grotick included.
Yes, Chairman, can I have just a question?
Yes.
Supposing we embark on some short-term borrowing, then the time comes and we find that we can't afford to repay it. What will happen?
Personally, I don't envisage that there will be a time that we will undertake short-term borrowing and not be in a position to repay it. Effectively, when we undertook the £2 million cash flow, sort of temporary borrowing from Middlesbrough, rather, we were looking at the amount of receipts that are going to come in during April, and then we had enough cash coming in, if you like, during that period of time to be able to repay that loan. So when we're taking out temporary borrowing, we're not doing it blindly. We are looking at the future when we return to a cash flow surplus. So the worst case scenario, I think as Councillor Billsbury just pointed out, if we didn't think we had enough cash coming in April, then I wouldn't have been going down the temporary borrowing route. I would have been saying to you, as members, we need to go and borrow long-term because there's a structural cash problem here, which is historic of the under-borrowed position. But our forecast suggests otherwise, and that we'll return to a cash surplus position, and therefore temporary borrowing was the most and the cheapest route for the council to go down. So we take that into consideration when we enter the loan.
Thank you,
Chairman. Yeah, I think the word that underpins the whole thing, and it is mentioned a lot in the report, the word is prudent. So we have a recommendation. Was that for 1, 2, 3, 4?
Yes, sixth chairman and a fifth, I think the one that Councillor Grotic...
Yes, absolutely, yes.
The new council reviews the capital programme.
Yeah, and seconded by Councillor McCarthy. Can we take this to vote? All those in favour? I think that's unanimous, just in case, any against? Thank you, which takes us to agenda item 4, council budget and council tax setting. I think over to Mr. Brown again.
Sorry, Chair, is there other papers?
I'm sorry, I'm just going 3-4 on it. I wasn't expecting to chair the meeting. Where are we now?
Medium-term capital programme.
Sorry, yes, medium-term capital
programme.
And then
the update on the financial position.
Fair enough, we'll go with that then.
Okay, so the medium-term capital programme, effectively it's approving the capital programme as has been previously approved within the council. So it sets out a current sort of update position on where we are in this financial year, and it also sets out the capital programme planned up until 2020-21, which is around £16.9 million worth of investment. And also details the amount of funding where that £16.9 million is to be funded. So that has all been factored in to the Treasury strategy as well as the budget that you're seeing today on today's agenda. And this is just to receive the updated medium-term capital programme and then to approve that as set out in Section 2 of the report. Happy to take any questions.
Are there any questions? Councillor Grotic.
Just a quick question, if I may. Is there any update on when the recycling project might actually start? It's something, as a councillor, I have been asked on several occasions.
Chairman, if I can actually answer that question really quite briefly. Recycling really is predicated on the completion of the redevelopment, which is ongoing, obviously, at the waste management site. We're hoping that that project will be completed, certainly by June of this year, and then that will give us the required space and the storage facilities so that we can start diverting some of our waste streams and actually processing. So recycling will be taking place later this year. We can't put a specific date on it yet because we still need to look at some of the logistical operations in terms of how we actually recycle on the islands and how we actually manage that process on the mainland. So we are in discussions at the moment, so that will be taking place. And of course, from the waste management's perspective, it'll be how we dispose of our waste which will actually give us the greatest savings moving forward.
Are there any other comments? If not, could perhaps have a recommendation? Richard?
Yes, thank you, Acting Chairman. again, on the waste situation, it talks about the costs coming down in the long term. How long is long term? Is it going to be done in a matter of 2, 3, 4, 5 years? Do we have anything more than a guess?
Again, Chairman, just to try and answer Councillor McCarthy's question succinctly, once we actually are in a position to actually change how we're disposing of our waste streams, which of course recycling will be a big part, then we should see costs actually fairly significantly driven down. So that should actually commence actually in the next financial year. And then of course moving forward, when in the longer term, the more on-island solutions that we can actually find through particularly the Smart Islands project, then of course our waste costs should actually drive down even further. So moving forward, in the short term, there should be some savings, but in the long term, there should be even some greater savings as well.
So that's 5 years, is it?
Well, we should be making savings, as I've explained, actually in the next financial year.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
So going onwards, so it's difficult to actually project at the moment, and that partly depends on if the implementation, for argument's sake, of the Smart Islands project in terms of particularly anaerobic digestion and gasification. But certainly in the short term, by actually diverting some of our waste streams, so it's not going to landfill, but it is actually either being recycled, where there's some added value, or it's actually going for energy for waste in one of the plants actually on the mainland. That will also drive down costs as well.
A second question, if I may. We've only spent about a third of our, perhaps a bit more than that, of our capital programme this year, $3 million against $7 million. Do we have the capacity to deliver what we haven't delivered in this financial year going forward?
I'll answer that, if I may, Richard. The capacity is a big issue, and as we go forward with more and more budget savings, that's going to be a bigger issue. That's where we have to be much cleverer about how we use capital grants and ensure that we put project teams in place to deliver those capital grants as part of the capital expenditure, rather than expect it to be done as part of the day jobs of the staff we're paying out of our revenue budgets. That's something that other councils have done right from the beginning, but we've really never done, and I think that's something we've got to get a lot better at. I think we've also been lucky in that projects have come in cheaper than we'd expected. So, for example, the Carn Thomas demolition project, significantly cheaper. Something's just been delayed by 2 or 3 months. So Longgrass, Strand, and the energy efficiency in housing. So I think we'll catch up a bit next year, but there is no way we'll probably spend another $3 million next year, but next financial year. But again, it's about getting clever about using some of that capital spend for project team costs. And that's how we'll deliver the projects.
Going to lose grant money in the process?
Not that I am aware of at all. So, for example, the ERDF project around flood defences has got a post as part of it, or part of a post as part of that project. That one's slow because of grant funding decisions between the EA and DCLG, but that one should have started in December, for example.
Councillor Saville.
Yes, Chairman. I'm looking at 2.4 on page 23. It explains where the money has come from for the capital programme, but it says 55,000 will need to be found from allocated spend and is currently in the revenue budget. I take that as being in this current year's revenue budget, and because we are talking about this year's capital expenditure, so that will be part of the overspend or incorporated within that that we are forecasting at the end of this month? Or is that money going to be carried forward into the 17-18 budget? I just want some clarification.
Mrs. Mompoloki?
That 55,000 is at the moment in our revenue budgets and is showing as revenue, but we are looking and we're undertaking a job at the moment of capitalising that revenue, because it is genuine capital spend and should be in our capital budgets, not going through our revenue budgets. So that should have an impact in lowering the impact on our general fund.
Right, so hopefully it will come out of this year's budget and it will not be carried forward to next year's budget.
No.
Yes, Chairman, on page 23, 2.2, in that column talking about grants, in the present year, 6 million, then it goes down to 4.9 million, etc. Are all these grants which are coming in between now and 2020, are they guaranteed? Can we say, hand in our heart, this money will be coming in then, or is it just an estimate?
I'd hesitate, think everybody would hesitate to guarantee anything in this world at the moment, but I'm Diana.
I would say all grants, by their very nature, are competitive, so you're competing with other people, so you always have, as you are further away from a grant, are less likely to know for sure if you're going to get it. These are grants that we know we're going to bid for and we have a good chance of acquiring, but you'll see that the grant amounts get lower towards the end of the programme because you have less certainty at that point. But the ones that you see there, the sort of £12 million worth of grants, are grants that we know are on the horizon and we are bidding for.
I agree, but knowing that they're on the horizon and all that, it's still no guarantee we're going to get them. And the Chancellor of the Exchequer tomorrow may cast a damper on all these grants.
There is no certainty you'll get any grant, But then I would say that it's unlikely some of these projects would go ahead if there was no grant. It wouldn't be then made to use council resources.
Okay, Chairman, that confirms uncertainty.
Are there any other comments? If not, perhaps we could go to recommendation.
Proposed recommendation that we approve the update.
Okay, seconded by Councillor Mumford. All those in favour? I'm fairly sure that is unanimous. Which takes us to the next urgent item, with the update on the financial position for 16-17.
Thank you, Chair. So this is an update on the current position of this financial year. The report doesn't update any further from the last report where we took to full council to say that the council is currently forecasting an overspend position of just over £800,000, which will be reduced to just under £500,000 if the trading account surpluses were taken into account, which were resolved in the last council meeting to do just that. So this builds on that report where we are trying to address the financial sustainability of the council, and in particular the level of the general fund reserve balance going forward. I think in the last report, the taking into consideration the forecast overspend even after the trading account surpluses were taken into account was going to reduce to a balance of around 42,000 going into financial year 17-18. So what we undertook was a review of the earmarked reserves and the unallocated specific grants that were being held on the council's balance sheet, and particularly those unallocated grants which have been historically held and not utilised in one form or another. So the report goes through and details that we've got as a council following the statement of accounts that was signed off. We have a reserve position of just over £6 million, which, as I say, does look relatively healthy, but when you analyse that down, the amount that's available in terms of a crisis is for the general fund position, if you like, is very limited. Of that £6 million, £4.2 million is held as earmarked reserves, and that's detailed on page 31 under 2.4, and then there's a table there that lists out the balances of the earmarked reserves as at the end of last financial year, 31st of March 2016. And in the review, what we've done is to look at those that are available in terms of are they being committed or not, what are they being held for, and just to undertake a quick review in the amount of time that we had available. So straight away, we excluded from the review reserves around the school, the water, the sewerage, and the airport, from the review in terms of those balances. So those balances have been left and will not be used going forward. Now, as you'll see from the report that was went to council last January, and obviously that's in the budget report as well, in-year surpluses that are made from those trading accounts will be utilised and are being proposed to be utilised, but the balances that are held in their own earmarked reserves are not being affected and not being touched. Going forward then, section 2.7 of the report then lists out the reserves that are intended to be utilised, and they add up to a total of 154,000, and they're listed at the bottom of page 31. And effectively what will happen is those reserves will cease to be at the end of this financial year, and we'll transfer those into the general fund. In addition to that, there's a list on Appendix 1, which is on page 33 of your papers, which lists all of the unallocated grants to a total of just under 933,000, which will be utilised and moved into the general fund. The result of that is shown under 2.10, page 32, and the table there, that by the virtue of moving the earmarked reserves that we've identified and the historic unallocated grants that have been listed in Appendix A, taking into account the forecast overspend, will ensure that there's a projected closing balance on the general fund of just over 1.1 million going forward. And that will put the council on a better financial footing to meet the challenges going forward in 17-18. It's within, it's just over its 1 million minimum requirement that was previously set. And as I say, it's critical that this happens to ensure that we've got the financial sustainability to meet the challenges for the budget in next financial year. I'm happy to take any questions.
Councillor Molson.
Yeah, Mr. Brown, thank you for your work on that and the clarity that is involved with it. I'm assuming that the projected closing balance of 1.129 million will therefore mitigate the need for us to go into borrowing so that we've got that cash reserve at the moment.
So just on the difference between reserve and our cash position. So what you see effectively on page 32 is the accounting position for the end of the financial year as opposed to the cash position. So where we have £933,000 worth of unallocated grants on our balance sheet, that is purely the accounting position. The actual cash is a different connotation and effectively it cannot be correlated to that accounting figure. Hence, that we still might, and we are in the position whereby we've had to go out and borrow temporarily for the £2 million because we haven't got the cash or forecast to have the cash remaining for the financial year. So it's two different things in terms of the 1.1 million projected balance is an accounting balance as opposed to a cash balance. Yes, that cash has come in at some point over the last five, six financial years, but with everything else that's been moving during that time, that cash has been utilised in some manner, and therefore it doesn't represent the actual cash position of the council. So you've got two different positions there. I appreciate that's a bit of a technical issue and may take getting your head around in terms of it doesn't correlate to our actual cash position.
Councillor Grotty?
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you to Andy Brown again for this report. 1.3, I'm sure everybody shares, on page 29 is extremely concerning, and I'm sure we all hope that we're going to move forward from what is obviously a very difficult position, and we obviously all share some responsibility for that position that we're in. If we could move, please, while approving the general tone of the recommendation and the principle behind it, that it is absolutely useless having money sitting somewhere and not using it, could I just say, and members perhaps will understand as Chair of Community Service, I would have to fight the corner, that several of these unallocated grants do look as if they should actually be transferred possibly straight to the Parkhouse overspend or somewhere within the adult social care budget. For example, one is clearly marked, three up from the bottom, NHS support for adult social care services. So it seems strange to me that it's sitting there. And there's also social services grants and a stroke care grant. I'm sure other members will look at their own service area and wonder really why they have been sitting there, but I'm glad that they're not going to sit there any longer, and at least if they go into general funds, then in one way, shape or form, they will be helping service delivery. So I'm not going to make a big thing about it, but I'd just like to comment.
Mrs. Hay.
Thank you, Councillor Gossick. I know exactly what you mean by that, what it looks like notionally, but actually the end point is exactly the same. Because obviously if we use those grants against the adult social care budget, it means there'll be less of a draw on the general fund to support the overspend. Also, a lot of those grants are ancient grants for way before my time, unpacking exactly what they were meant to do. It's when we used to be gifted money, which we found very hard to spend. We're no longer in that fortunate position. So I think it's still the same thing. Absolutely, you could offset it directly against the Parkhouse and adult social care budget, but it still has the same impact for the budget as a whole.
Thank you for another clear report, Andy, but also thank you, Diana, because you were the one who spent untold hours scrabbling around trying to find all the money behind all the cushions on the sofa, didn't you? Are there any other comments? If not, Councillor Savile.
Yes, Chairman, you've actually just said what I was going to say. I would like to thank, obviously, Mr Brown for all the work he's put in, but I know Mrs Mompoloki has done an awful lot of the groundwork and her team within finances, so due thanks are due to them as well. I think this is a very sensible way forward to replenishing our general fund reserves, and therefore I propose the recommendation.
I would second that.
Okay. Well, may we take this to a vote then?
Chairman, sorry, could I just make a point? I am slightly nervous about some of the things listed here in the same way that Councillor Gossick was. I mean, for instance, £50,000 earmarked for use on the buzzer bus is actually going into the list. Now, I suspect that may well have been because we were going to have to buy a new battery for the old electric bus. But it's certainly slightly worrying. I wouldn't want the buzzer bus to fail as an investment because we're taking £50,000 out of an earmarked reserve. And ditto, I'm also slightly nervous about the large, the points that Councillor Rockcottick made, but also about the amount of money in, that is going into the general fund to do with coastal risk management and funding for coastal protection. These are quite considerable sums, best part of $250,000. And again, I'm slightly nervous that this doesn't get allocated for something else when coastal protection is one of the clear things, clear priorities of our spend, I would have thought.
Ashley?
Thank you, Chairman. So, Councillor McCarthy, on the buzzer bus one, just to reassure you, that, again, is historic. Before my time, buzzer bus was commissioned slightly differently, and the council made a capital purchase of a vehicle and then contracted AGK to operate it. As you'll be aware from community services meetings recently, we've changed that model. We now have a contract with AGK, and we lease a vehicle, and I should think actually it's been proved to be a much more reliable model going forward. So we don't need to have that reserve to buy a brand new vehicle.
Can I just reassure Councillor McCarthy, I've been in very detailed discussions with Julian Pearce over the coastal defences management, and that will not affect our effectiveness at all to proceed with that. There are a lot of projects that, if you remember the paper that came to the last Teddy meeting, that are going to be hopefully funded. We can't guarantee, as in any grant form whatsoever, but are hopefully going to be funded in an ongoing process, and that will not affect our ability to respond to that.
Chair, if I may, can I just also add that the transfers, just to give a bit of assurance to councillors, who I understand are potentially uneasy about the list, certainly in Appendix 1 and also the amount reserves as well. All the transfers, specifically around the unallocated grants, will be subject to the ratification and testing by the external auditor as part of the closure of accounts for this financial year. So that $933,000 that's listed in Appendix 1, each one will be tested in terms of the terms and conditions of the grant and its justification about moving that into the general fund. So although this is our proposal, it still has to get through the external auditor test as well at the year end, just to add a further reassurance.
Mrs. Mompoloki.
Can I just add that these are revenue grants, not capital grants? So we have a separate big long list of capital grants. These are just the revenue grants. So I think that makes it easier to move them into the general fund.
Molly.
Can I just be assured that the funding for coastal protection, if there is an emergency, we will have enough money to sort it out, please?
Can I cover that one? In terms of, this is precisely one of the reasons why we are bolstering the general fund back up to the minimum level of £1 million. It's to do with our contingency and our ability to be resilient and deal with financial shocks to the system. And you, as you'll see in the budget papers, as Section 151 officer, I've done a risk assessment of potential financial shocks to the authority, which covers urgent costs arising due to weather-related incidents, for example. And that's the perfect example of why we held a general fund reserve and a general fund reserve balance, is to deal with financial shocks to the system. And therefore, with the ability, with the general fund balance back up around the minimum level, there is the ability to deal with those financial shocks coming forward.
I believe, unless you want to come back on that, Craig.
Just very briefly, Chairman, those that attended the Transport Economic and Infrastructure meeting will know that we're actually moving towards a flood management strategy. So we are looking at ongoing capital investments, but also in emergency situations, of course, we do have our own kind of emergency planning procedures, and there are obviously government grants as well through the things like the Bellwind scheme, which actually can help us if we do actually face an emergency through, for argument's sake, coastal flooding.
Thank you very much.
Chairman, I smile at that, because when the CETA went aground in 1997, this authority got not one penny from the Bellwind Fund.
Colin.
Thank you, Chairman. Can I ask when we expect the external auditor to give their opinion on our accounts?
About a month ago, wasn't it?
Chair, I'll cover that one. So they've given their opinion, as we all know, from the 15-16 last financial year's accounts. That was signed off in the last council meeting in January. There's still a few outstanding issues that we need to resolve before we get their final certification, but we're resolving those. And if I may, if I just provide a little bit of update on particularly the financial expertise and capacity within the organisation. I've just recently recruited to a technical accountant to assist us over the close down. He'll be principally working from the mainland, but he's already been out to the islands to see the systems, and vice versa. The finance staff on the islands have also been over to the mainland to receive training and also to look at the guidance and the principles and processes for improving the close down for this set of accounts. So for 16-17, the opinion should be presented to council in September. However, I am in discussion with the external auditor in terms of a potential delay, recognising the problems that we had in closing the accounts for 15-16 and the issues that we have well documented within the system, whether there's a potential for a delay in submitting the draft accounts, which I have to do by the end of May, and then they will audit those accounts, and an opinion normally should be presented by the end of September. However, at this moment, I am in discussion with the external auditor in terms of whether we can extend that beyond the end of September, recognising the unique circumstances that we have in closing our accounts.
I think we have a proposal in a second. Now, I think we can now take it to a vote. All those in favour of the recommendation? Again, that is unanimous. Which I believe now takes us to agenda item 4. Budget and council tax.
Okay, thank you, Chair. So this is the annual council approval of the council's budget for next financial year 17-18, as well as the formal council tax setting for next financial year as well. The recommendations are set out in page 1, give the rises that are required in the level of council tax for the council for next financial year. The total set of the budget to be set, and then also going forward, the approval of the future year savings as well for the medium term. So this builds on the previous report to the council, in where a list of savings totaling $544,000 were approved, and then builds upon that and sets a balanced budget as well. So just going through the report, on page bottom of page 2 and then over to page 3, I set out the approach to this year's budget, and also then set out the final settlement for the authority in 1718. So just quickly on the approach, realising that a lot will be caveated over the systems that we are struggling with in terms of the financial transparency for the authority and the processes, sitting down with the corporate leadership team, which comprises the chief executive and the senior managers, we set about looking at those savings proposals that were approved in January and setting a base budget for 17-18. So going forward, I asked the CLT, the corporate leadership team, to set a balanced budget, but principally under a budget tree, if you like, in terms of how they would want to set a budget for 17-18 going forward, and the amount and level of spend that they would be required to meet that budget for 17-18. Now, the details for that are contained in Appendix 3 on page 15, in terms of sets out the detail for the proposed budget in very high level, but breaks down by the senior manager officer the responsibility for their areas and their proposed net budget following the savings going forward. So that was the approach. My thanks do go to the corporate leadership team, because that was over a very short amount of time. A lot of hard work was put in to ensure that that budget was created and set in the short amount of time that we've had available to do that. Because effectively, it was a zero-based budget that we've put together and then presented here today. Going forward, then page 3, final settlement, just details. The final settlement from the government, which was announced by the Secretary of State on the 20th of February, and as previously reported, our core spending, which includes an estimate of council tax rises, is actually going to go up by 1.1%. The level of reduction in our revenue support grant from the government is only 1.5%, when across the country other councils have seen a reduction of around 30%. So in effect, the council has been protected in some way in terms of revenue grant reductions. And the table at the bottom of page 3 details out the amount of resources that this council can expect to receive going in to financial year 17-18, but it doesn't obviously include the amount that's going to be set today around council tax. Just picking up on the resources, when completing a statutory return to government, which is called, lovingly titled, the NNDR1 return, we unfortunately uncovered an error in the previous return that meant we were going into financial year 17-18 with a deficit of around £240,000. Under the 50% retention scheme, we have to rectify £120,000, so 50% of the £240,000, immediately in 17-18. So that was an added one-off burden that we had to deal with in next financial year. And it's proposed, and as we just approved the increase into the general fund, that we use immediately an element of the general fund to deal with that £120,000, and it is a one-off in next financial year. That will therefore limit the further reductions in services going forward, and we deal with that in 17-18. On page 4, it then details the council tax base for 2017-18, and then also the announcements around the adult social care levy. So you can see that the council tax base for 17-18 has been calculated at 1,322 Band D properties, and that forms part of the council tax resolutions that are detailed in Appendix 1, and that is based on a collection rate which has remained unchanged at 97.9%. It's a slight increase on the previous year's Band D council tax base, which was, I think, 1,321, and there's about a 0.26% increase. The settlement also announced a continuation of the adult social care precept, but as previously mentioned, it allowed authorities to increase the additional precept of 2% up to 3% for the next 2 years. So in recognising that and the current financial position of the authority, as well as the detailed documented pressures within adult social care, the papers do propose a 3% levy is put on the bills for 2017-18 as well as 2018-19, and that will raise an additional just short of £15,000 on the existing 2% levy, with a total of £44,000 being passported to the adult social care service. As I said, Appendix 1 details the resolutions that are required to formally set the council tax, and they are detailed on pages 12 and page 13 as well. That also includes details of the Devon and Cornwall Police and Crime Commissioner tax bandings for the year, as well as the Council of the Isles of Scilly's individual elements, subject to those being approved today. Then moving forward, we've talked about the general fund reserves, so we've covered that off in a previous report in terms of the balance brought forward going into financial year 2017-18 is based now on the figure of 1.129 million. As I obviously previously just explained about the use to offset immediately the NNDR deficit of 120,000, that will bring us down to a forecast closing balance for next financial year, so March 2018, of just over £1 million. But that, of course, is caveated against ensuring that the budget that we're setting today is balanced. And you know, you'll see in a minute in terms of the risk, I think, that we are facing in terms of delivering a balanced budget going forward. So then, balancing the budget, we'd already approved £544,000 worth of savings. But in taking that into consideration, with the use of the general fund reserve to offset the 120,000, there's still an overall 400,000 deficit in the proposed budget. So we've pulled forward a further 65,000 of additional savings for 17-18. So now the total savings target for 17-18 stands at £609,000, and that's detailed on page 6. And there's a table and a list of the savings that are being proposed for 17-18. It's previously documented that going forward, each of those savings will be referenced, and those will be tracked and reported back to members to provide that transparency about savings delivery going forward. In addition to the 120,000, there is also an amount being met from reserve in relation to special educational needs of 164,000, and that will be met from an earmarked reserve held to deal with that. That will bring down the deficit to around 226,000, and it's proposed going forward, and it's detailed at the bottom of page 6, that the trading accounts surpluses, which are forecast to be around 300,000 in 17-18, there's a contribution from those in-year surpluses to the overall general fund budget of 226,000 to ensure that we have a balanced budget going forward in 17-18. As you can see in the report, I'm saying that going forward, that we look to, when things are on a more financial even keel, that we look to replenish those trading account surpluses to the tune that has been drawn down to balance the budget. But going forward for 17-18, and to ensure that we do have a robust and a balanced budget, there is a contribution that is going to be made from the surplus of the trading accounts. Page 7 then details the overall high-level view of the budget. So you've got net spend of services before proposed savings of 5.6 million. The savings will take that down to 5 million. We're then looking for a trading account contribution of 226,000. We then detail the funding that we expect from government, council tax and business rates to ensure that we have a balanced budget going forward. Section 7 then talks about future savings. And it's clear that there's still going to be a structural deficit going forward within the council's finances. Clearly, we have to address the trading account contribution, and there's other with the contribution from reserves. there's also other structural deficits in there that need to be addressed, which is around the tune of over 300,000.
Andy, so could I just stop you for 1 second? Know what a structural deficit is, but I'm sure there are some people in the wider public and possibly in the room who are not familiar with the term. Perhaps you could just explain it a little?
Yeah, sure. So, structural deficit, basically, if I take you to the table of page 7, you can see that our total resources and total funding coming into the council totals 4.798 million. So effectively, our spend on services should equal 4.798 million. When in fact, our spend on services, as detailed in that table, is actually 5 million. So at the minimum, there's a structural deficit of 226,000, which effectively we're plugging with the use of trading account surpluses for 17-18. But in addition to that, there's also the line just above the net spend on services, which is contribution from reserves. And as reserves are one-off, and not ongoing, there is an element of those that we also take into consideration because they won't be there forever, as you presented. So in addition to the 609,000 that we're proposing for 17-18, there's a list of savings planned for future years of just over £250,000, and they will be used to be worked up and designed to be filtered into the review of the medium-term financial plan, which is going to be needed in the next administration. Formal council tax resolutions, 17-18, I've spoken about, but at the bottom of page 8 just gives you an overall view of the increases for the Council of the Isles of Scilly, which is a 4.99% increase in the Band D charge, and then for the Devon and Cornwall Police and Crime Commissioner, which gives you an overall increase for council tax for Band D residents on the islands. Then just going forward, on page 9 is the section 151 officers review, and it goes on in quite detail to then page 10. So as part of the budget, I have to give my opinion on the robustness of the budget and also the level of reserves as well. So as I was outlined in the review, this budget has been set with a high level of risk. And it's on the backdrop of the current financial position, the systems and the control environment of the council, and it comes off the back of the Section 24 notice that was issued by the external auditor in the sign-off of the 15-16 accounts. However, with the utilisation of the specific grants and earmarked reserves, we've bolstered the general fund reserve over to its minimum level of £1 million. There's still this structural deficit that we'll need addressing in future years. But on the basis of those actions that have happened, yes, the budget is on the very limit of prudence in the next financial year, but I'm happy to sign off the budget in terms of those actions that we have undertaken. When considering the level of reserves, Appendix 2 is something that I've introduced, and that's detailed on page 14, and that is a risk assessment of the level of general fund balance that the council should be holding. You can see that totals 1.1 million, and it's an estimate of all the elements that might hit us in terms of financial risk during next financial year, and the likelihood to give a weighted magnitude in terms of financial coverage and scope that may hit the authority and therefore give rise to the level of general fund reserves that we should be holding. So that's factored in, but the fact that we've addressed the general fund in the previous report gives me the confidence to sign the budget off, although being on the very limit of prudence and the fact that we are entering 17-18 on a very tightrope going forward with our finances, but that we have a budget going forward that is balanced, will need to be managed very carefully, but we're in a position to set a budget and a council tax. The rest of the review highlights out some more specific risks, but I'm happy to leave it there and take any questions, Chair.
Yeah, Gordon, I think you're champing at the bit here, aren't you? Gordon.
Yes, Chairman, I have several questions, if you'll bear with me. First of all, we are going to save, it's on page 6, £200,000 on recovery of commercial waste. I've never had any details of how we are going to achieve this. Can one of the officers tell us? Craig.
Chairman, again, just very briefly, in terms of the overall savings to waste management, it's not just in terms of commercial waste. It's actually looking at all of our waste management strategy in the round. So the biggest savings will actually, as I've already said this morning, will actually be in terms of how we're disposing of our waste streams. And that's obviously predicated on the fact that we will be recycling and we will not be landfilling, but we will also be disposing of our residual waste through energy for waste. So the biggest savings, so that everyone's absolutely aware, generally will be in disposal costs. What we're also doing, and members will be aware, particularly in the Transport Economic Development and Infrastructure Committee, that I do have an element of delegation in consultation with the Chair and Vice Chair to ensure that the commercial fees and charges are on the basis of full cost recovery. So that does give us some flexibility as well going forward in terms of generation of income.
But does this mean that the producers of commercial waste will have to pay a lot more for its disposal?
Chairman, it gives us flexibility. So therefore, if disposal costs actually start coming down, and also collection costs, then obviously that has a corresponding impact on fees and charges. So it's not necessarily just about year-on-year increasing fees and charges. There may be, if waste management actually pans out as we think it might do, maybe there may be some reductions. But obviously it's very difficult to crystal ball gaze. But the point is, what we're looking at in terms of waste management moving forward is that we have a much more viable, a much more sustainable model, and that we are actually diverting some of our waste streams so that it is actually creating beneficial use, whether it's energy for waste or whether it's being reused or recycled, which of course does add value. That means we'll never ever make any money from our waste streams, because obviously we do have the geographic disadvantage of actually putting most of our disposal routes back to the mainland, and of course with that comes transportation costs.
And moving on from that, Chairman, I note on the same page it is suggested, in fact agreed, that we're going to make a fortnightly waste collection in the winter instead of weekly, and we're going to save £49,500 with this. Many people only have one dustbin, and they generate the same amount of waste in the summer as in the winter. And this could mean dustbin bags which are taken out of dustbins.
Councillor Billsborough, we went through this at the previous council meeting. I don't know if there's a great deal of utility retreading it. I do take your point. I think the issue is that things keep a lot better in the winter than the summer.
Well, all right, then a spare dustbin. If a dustbin bag is left out more out in the open, it's liable to be damaged by seagulls. The other thing is you're going to reduce street sweeping. Is that correct? On the agenda. Right.
Chairman, I'll be really brief on this. So in terms of how we're actually moving forward, again, in principle, what we have discussed is fortnightly collections actually in the winter time. Reality is, of course, that as we are moving forward, and as we are beginning to recycle, then obviously we do need to actually completely review the operation in terms of how we're collecting our waste, because clearly if we're recycling and we have residual waste as well, then therefore we do need to make sure that our collection rounds do actually correspond to an element of recycling and an element of residual waste. What I would say in terms of recycling, that means your black bag waste actually is significantly reduced, so therefore that also perhaps allows us to collect on a fortnightly basis. In terms of street sweeping, that's something we are actually looking at, because we can make, again, some savings, and that's really dependent, again, on terms of how we actually manage the collection of waste going forward, because it's actually tied up with our operational services team.
Thank you. Now, moving on from there, Chairman, we are going to get an extra 3%. If we raise the council tax by an extra 3%, this can go towards adult social care. We have a problem, as you know, on adult social care, and one of the things which worries me is there's this possibility, or we know that Park House is not receiving sufficient funding, or we can't get staff for it. I know the officers are exercising everything they can to make sure we have staff, but at the end of the day, closing Park House must not even be an option. Could I ask a comment on this?
Gordon, I don't think we need to retread this one again.
I think the question should be answered.
Well, I think it has been answered on numerous occasions. There is no appetite whatsoever within the authority for closing Park House. But right. Can I just pass you on to Mrs. Hick for a second?
Okay, the budget set for Park House is it's been done really well this year, and it reflects realistic income levels and it reflects realistic use of agency staff. So the current budget put in front of members is to fund the status quo. In the last couple of weeks, you will be aware that there has been a recruitment crisis at Park House, which we are trying to work our way through. I will just say, saying that no one has an appetite to close Park House is not actually helpful. What is important is safe care. If we cannot overcome this recruitment crisis, I, as a nominated individual, will make a decision about the ongoing viability of Park House, and I'm afraid that will not be a member decision. It will be about the safety of care we provide to those residents.
And finally, Chairman, you'll be pleased to hear that all in all, we will still have a budget deficit of about £390,000. That's mentioned on page 9. The bottom line is that because we've only got just over 2,000 people here, we are not large enough and we cannot produce enough in order to maintain all the essential services. If we are going to achieve a balanced budget, we are going to have to cut essential services or, alternatively, go to the government. The chief exec and the chairman have got to say, look, we've made all the cuts we can and we cannot make any more. And we have to tell them
we were retreading old ground, and this has always been in process, and I don't think there's much utility in revisiting it. But yes, absolutely, that's what the council does, and the council does it all the time.
Well, as long as I have an assurance, Chairman, that at the end of the day, sooner than have unacceptable cuts to the frontline services, the Chairman and the Chief Exec will go to the government and say, look, we can't do it, we need more help.
I think, Gordon, we continue going to government. Councillor Grotick.
Thank you, Chairman. This actually leads quite nicely into the first of the two comments I would like to quickly make, which is on page 3 at 3.2, I really welcome the fact that our revenue support grant has been protected, which is very welcome. But I would just like to publicly thank our local MP, Derek Thomas, for his recent intervention, which is recorded on Hansard. And he actually does say that for a rural community like ourselves, with the responsibility of a unitary authority, it is extremely difficult balancing the budget. And he actually has put a speech into the public domain, which quite frankly is excellent, and I would commend everyone to try and have a look at it. Secondly, on a more specific issue, on page 8, we are looking at item number 6, in the recommendation slightly worries me. On page 8, the list does include the savings to be implemented in 17-18, the suggestion that we are going to try, as indeed we will, to save money from our active silly leisure provision. Obviously, we only have certain leisure provisions. We can't go to an adjacent village or town to source another leisure provision should one close. So I would just say we have already agreed to do a community impact assessment around active silly provision involving the new academy sponsor for the school and public health and the NHS, and I hope we're going to move forward with that fairly swiftly. And I would like to ask members if they would be prepared to amend recommendation 6 that the plan savings for future years be approved to form the basis of planning for the medium term, subject where appropriate to the relevant community impact assessments in view of any change to proposed service delivery, which I believe in some cases is the statutory requirement anyway.
I would support that, Chairman.
I would have, I don't think anybody would have any issue with that. I don't think it makes much material difference, so that's fine.
Would you like to put it to the vote then, Chairman? Can I make that proposal that we amend?
If anybody's prepared to second that, but I don't know if we've quite finished discussing this yet, that's all. Councillor Saville.
Chairman, I was just going to comment that within the whole of the report and the finances that have been brought to us today, there's no mention of the Isles of Scilly Education Grant. Well, I know that is comes in to the council, and the vast majority is transported straight across to the school. But just over 600,000 of it is used to support the authority, goes to the children's services within the authority. And although there are very positive conversations going on with the DfE, I think that is another risk with the future academy status of the school. If that is in any way is altered, it is a risk to the authority around the share that we currently take for delivery of services within the island. So I therefore think that, you know, the Elsicilly Education Grant is part of our funding, and I think it should be at least be mentioned in any report. I know it doesn't impact on council tax.
Colin, I believe.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm coming back to this waste collection every fortnight. I'm assuming that only applies to St Mary's, because the contractor on St Martin's tells me he doesn't charge for collection, and therefore it would be pointless to reduce it to one a fortnight.
Yes, I don't. Well, that's absolutely fine. I assume that would be the case. Are there any other comments? We have a recommendation with Councillor Gosick's amendment. Richard?
Yes, as a fortnight, Chairman, I do have one simple question which I think is important. I see we're going to save £20,000 by disposing of the Wesleyan Chapel, i.e. we're going to dispose of the council chamber and save £20,000. Where are we going to meet?
I think the last meeting we decided on your house, didn't we, Gordon? But we can't anywhere in the world the chairman nominates to have a council meeting, you can have it. It's just entirely down to the chairman. We had the town hall, there were various places. We've had council meetings in other buildings that the council possesses. I don't think that's an issue. And we will not dispose of the Wesleyan Chapel and have somewhere else to meet. Councillor?
Thanks, Chairman. Can I put a formal request at this stage that it be somewhere warmer than the Wesleyan Chapel?
I think that's a very, very good idea.
Chairman, you shouldn't have even thought of it without thinking where we're going to meet. It's all right, so we'll find somewhere. But that's not the way to run a railway.
Well, fortunately, we're not a railway. And are there, Richard? I think did you come in? I'm losing track.
Yeah, perhaps Councillor Bills will turn his light off. Thank you, because I just wanted to sort of again thank Mr. Brown for all the work he's done on this. It's very clear, and he talked us through it very, very well. He didn't mince his words, which I think is quite appropriate. We need to be absolutely clear about our situation. But I am a little bit nervous about how we possibly could have lost or got £120,000 wrong with our business rate collection. And also, I don't know quite what the high needs, special educational needs figure is all about on page 7. Again, it appears to be a further drain on our expected outturn. I also agree with Councillor Grotic on the subject of recommendation 6, these savings for future years. In fact, I'm just about happy with that recommendation. I tend to think this should be left to the next council, to be left after May, because, you know, it's all very well for us to take a decision now on this. These are future savings, and we still don't know exactly what our outturn is. The figures we've had, as I understand it, only go up to the end of December. So I am a bit nervous about actually saying this is what we're going to do.
I think, Richard, I think really these are our roles. We make them, and the new council can change them. I don't think it's really material, but however, I do take your point.
Can I just say on that, Chairman, I think it's appropriate for us to make a suggestion to the new council, to present this information and say, we've looked at it and this is what we've identified as potential savings. Now it's for you to run with it and to make your own decision. I completely agree with that. But I think it's appropriate for us to use this as a starting block.
Yes, Chairman, I'll just answer the point about the so-called drain on resources. I really would be careful about words that we're funding our statutory responsibilities to children with special educational needs. And we did have a reserve built up over time. Somebody alluded to the fact that positive conversations have taken place with the departments. I went to see them about 10 days ago. It looks as if we can safeguard the school share of funding till 2020, the LA share of funding to 2020, and potentially access additional money for residential boarding placements. But nothing's, there's still a risk, as Councillor Saville says, until we get a piece of paper to confirm that.
Are there any other? Councillor Moulson.
One general point is that over the past 8 years or so, we've had a limit set by the government on the maximum rise that we can authorise by council tax rises. I fully understand the need of our funding situation and the potential problems thereof. However, I would just like to put on record that the poor council taxpayer has been asked to pay again, 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 and again. This isn't necessarily our, as in council's, fault. Is a lot of it is the funding gap that we are not receiving from central government.
I think we possibly all concur with that one, Ted. Is there anybody? Does anybody else have a comment? Otherwise, I think we have a proposer. Councillor Bilsborough has seconded it with Councillor Grotwick's amendment, which I think we're fairly clear about. So on that basis, can I take this to a vote? All those in favour? Oh yes, and this is the big council tax one, so it's recorded. So do we need to go around the room? But if it's unanimous, that's just everybody. No, we have to do it formally. Okay. Okay, one, two. On that basis, I will take one, two, and three together, which is the recorded part. So, may I have? I know your views, Councillor Bilsborough. Yeah, I think. No, it's not proposing it. It's agreeing. You are now voting. This is for one, two, and three.
Happy with that.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
Just go round. I don't need to sort of just.
Yes.
Oh, I need to call up the names as well. Okay, Robert. Councillor Doyle Smith. Councillor Mullins.
Councillor Mullins, support.
Councillor
Mumford, support.
Councillor Moulson, with a heavy heart, supports.
Councillor O'Neill, in favour.
Councillor Barclay, I'm trying to say that.
Councillor Barclay, in favour.
Councillor McCarthy.
Councillor McCarthy, in favour.
Councillor Hicks.
Councillor Hicks in favour.
Councillor Guy. Councillor Saville.
Councillor Saville in favour.
Councillor Peacock.
Councillor Peacock in favour.
Councillor Grotwick.
Councillor Grotwick in favour.
Councillor Daly.
Councillor Daly in favour.
Councillor Francis.
Councillor Francis support.
And Councillor Sims support. I believe that was unanimous. And now for 4, 5, and 6, which has 6 having Councillor Grotwick's amendment. May all those in favour? Again, we have a unanimous vote. Well, thank you very much. Which?
Chairman, can I just indulge me for one moment?
You certainly
may. We've obviously spoken a lot, and we're all fully aware of our financial situation as an authority today. But let us not forget the good and positive things that come out of this authority. Our children's services were rated good in the previous year, in the lower quartile of the rest of the country. Very few people other authorities achieve that. Park House is rated good by the Quality Care Commission. So, and a lot of other good work is being done within infrastructure, and the waste has already been spoken about today. So let us not be too pessimistic. I am naturally an optimistic person. So go forward with a great deal of optimism into the next council.
Thank you for that. It's a very good point. And I think I could probably add to it, as far as I'm aware, none of our frontline services have yet been impacted. Now, I think there's very few authorities in the country could say that, though.
Yeah, I'd like to
don't know if that's the case still.
And say it's still the best place in the world to live.
That's a reasonable recommendation. And I just noticed an urgent item, and it's going to, and I don't wish to be silly, but Fraser, you have a drawing pin in your left shoe, which will become urgent for you at some point. which I think, believe, brings us on to agenda item 5, the proposals for government's arrangements, which are, I'm not sure who's leading on this. Richard, are you on the phone?
I am indeed. Good morning, everyone.
That makes it much easier. Well, if I let you take off, thank you.
Yes, so thank you, Chairman, and good morning, members. We can't be with you in person. Richard Williams and Andy Brown
has left the conference.
Richard, are you still with us? That's what I thought. We need to get the technical people. We'll have a couple of minutes recess.
Richard Williams
has joined the conference.
Hello.
Hello, Richard. Thank you for coming back.
Sorry about that. We got cut off.
It's all right. We had a very welcome little break then. If you'd like to...
Oh, right, good.
...start on agenda item 5, we'd be much appreciated. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much indeed. Apologies for that. As I was saying gladly to myself a few minutes ago, so effectively this is the first part of a two-part process. So we have an outline report that hopefully members can support today in terms of the revised governance arrangements to come into force in the new council. Obviously, if members support that, we'll bring a further detailed report to the annual meeting in May, which will set out obviously all the supporting documentation that is required and all the supporting processes required to obviously implement the decision that you're taking. So right at the outset, if I could just thank the members of the Democratic Processes Panel, who I know have done an awful lot of work in developing and reviewing these proposals, and also to give my thanks to Andrew and Bob and all other officers who I know also have worked very hard on the culmination of a lot of months of work today. So moving to paragraph 1.3 on the top of page 2, that sets out the broad principles that have guided the work of the Democratic Processes Panel and their recommendations, which I think you'll all be aware of. Clearly, to enhance the democratic authority of members is always a good principle to have with governance. Secondly, of course, you'll all be aware of the work of the Boundary Commission in terms of reducing the number of elected members from 21 to 16. So it's entirely appropriate appropriate to review the governance arrangements to reflect that decision. Clearly, in doing any new governance arrangements, we have to meet the council's statutory requirements. And finally, and very importantly, in my view, although you don't, because of the streamlined committee system, doesn't require legally to have scrutiny, I think the best practice clearly to have it, and as part of the governance arrangements to get a new and revitalised, if I might use that word, scrutiny arrangements within the council. So moving on to paragraph 1.4, clearly the initial recommendations are that those committees bullet pointed will be abolished and replaced by effectively full council taking those responsibilities over. 1.4.2, as a consequence of that, of course, with the abolition of the Children's Committee, there are certain boards that have to be put in place, and that obviously refers to the Corporate Parenting Board and the new Children's Partnership Board, which will be set up. And as I've indicated, we will be bringing forward detailed proposals as to how those will operate, if you agree in principle to this. 1.4.3 is the statutory committees, of course, that are bullet pointed there that we have to retain. So obviously you can read those down from licensing committee down to the community safety partnership. And as I've already referred to, although it's not a statutory requirement, it's proposed that a scrutiny committee is established, which will discharge the audit and scrutiny functions currently undertaken by the Finance Audit and Scrutiny Committee. And, of course, the finance, the very important finance purposes and responsibilities of that committee will pass to full council. And, obviously, the health scrutiny function will also be retained within full council. So I think the next thing is around scheduling member meetings. And clearly it sets out there in quite some detail the importance, of course, of abolishing a number of those policy committees and replacing them by full council. There are a number of issues why we consider that having a monthly schedule for full council meetings would be required, and those are set out in the bullet points 1.7.1 to 1.7.18. And I think we've just made a sort of little caveat in 1.8 that clearly in terms of where council business is transacted and then moving to what we put in inverted commas corporate business, obviously we'll need to give some thought as to how that happens, but it is not uncommon to have that sort of scheme in place where you effectively move from full council to a committee or a full council sitting as a committee. So we'll be able to do that, but obviously that's one of the things that we will bring back to full council in May. 1.9 then talks about member roles and responsibilities, and obviously with full council taking over the responsibilities for a number of committees, obviously we won't have the chair and vice chair roles for those committees anymore. They're all listed at 1.10. And obviously the Democratic Processes Panel gave careful consideration to that, and it is their belief that there are three lead members that will still be required under the new regime: lead member for adults, lead member for place, and not surprisingly in view of your previous debate, lead member for finance. So obviously we will look at that. In terms of financial implications of that, and I'll come back to the recommendations later and the options, but there are additional, I know financial implications didn't guide the principles of the Democratic Process Panel quite rightly, but obviously it's good to note that significant savings will be made in addition to securing the meeting of the other principles. Financial savings will be made. The extent of those financial savings, of course, won't be clearly known until the Independent Remuneration Panel has sat and considered and made recommendations in relation to any SRAs being paid to lead members or other members of the council. But clearly there is significant savings that will be made. Other implications are then set out in the report. I think the only thing I would mention before referring back to page one of the recommendations, and I think it came out I think it was Councillor Glossick who made the point in terms of the report that Andy presented. I think with any new governance system, of course, it's absolutely key that there's effectively members are trained and effectively trained, and when we come back in May, we will set out details of proposed member training at induction, clearly specific training on scrutiny, I think we'll be looking at, and also code of conduct training, which we provide you on a regular basis, but of course we'll do so at an early stage in the new council. So that, in essence, is the report, which, as I say, is I think, believe, heartily endorsed by the Democratic Processes Panel, which I know obviously has a number of the members of the Council on it. So I would, on that basis, commend recommendations 1 to 6 to you. Again, thank the panel and the officers for their work, and as your monitoring officer, confirm that I'm entirely happy that the 6 recommendations are fully lawful, and I believe will leave the new Council in a strong place to go forward. Thank you, Chair.
I think Councillor Grotic, I believe you put your hand up first.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm sure colleagues will want to comment. This is a very useful document, but it's very much a work in progress. And it needs a lot more detail and fleshing out, I think, before I personally have confidence to support, even in principle, recommendations 1 to 6. I believe it is also a little presumptuous of us to set in stone the working arrangements for a new council, which may be significantly different in composition to those of us who sit round this table now. So I would like to put a proposal on the table, and my proposal is this. My proposal is that the newly elected council be recommended to investigate further and decide their preferred working structure, aided by the Democratic Processes Panel and this report, after the next elections.
I'll second that, Chairman.
I was actually, yeah, sorry.
Whoops. yeah, fine. I think we could probably do a little bit more discussion before we take that to a vote, but yeah, I accept that. Councillor, but I think Councillor Billsborough, why not?
Yes, Chairman, I would second that. I agree that the present council structure needs some updating, but this does not qualify the virtual demolition of the present system simply because we are reducing the number of councillors. But it's not part of the debate, but we should ask ourselves why there's been a lack of candidates to fill our present vacancies. Going on to the main theme, referring to, for a start, I believe that as at present, each committee should have a chairman and a vice chairman. It's now proposed for some committees that they have a so-called lead member and no deputies. I would challenge that. Referring to paragraph 1.718, the report, I notice it's been suggested that the meeting times of committees and the council should be at 9:30, 11:30 and 13:30. In other words, there will be no evening meetings throughout the year.
I think that there has been a misunderstanding on this. The timing of meetings will always be subject to whatever the chairman decides.
Well,
and
right,
I see no reason why we will not. We will have evening meetings in the summer. I don't think that's an issue. I think
Okay,
it's in there, but I don't think that is pertinent, really.
It is pertinent, Chairman. If we are going to agree, according to this, it's like that. All day town meeting, but I'll move on from there, but that's my point. The reason for this is that during the summer, many members who are in full-time employment have commitments and work, and they should not be denied the opportunity or have problems by having to attend daytime meetings in the summer. I hope that's amended. Now, I also realise that the new structure will save money. But we must be careful not to sacrifice democracy on the altar of so-called cost saving. There's always this danger. We can save money, you know, but... And finally, I believe, and I agree with Councillor Cotter, that the details of the proposed restructuring of the committees should be further examined by the present council, but no decisions can be made until the newly elected council has had an ample opportunity to form an opinion on the matter and make the final decisions. In the meantime, the existing committees should, where possible, retain their present composition and terms of reference until all the newly elected members have had an ample opportunity to form an opinion. In other words, no decisions on this now. It must be done by the new council. We can't hand on to them something we have done. I know some will say time's against us. We should have thought of this sooner, but we didn't. But we can't rush it through now, just to save time.
I think that this, the Boundary Commission, rather, brought this on, Gordon. However, thank you for your comments. Councillor O'Neill, I should have come to you before.
That's all right, no problem. Thank you, Chairman. Yes. I actually agree with most of what Councillor Billsborough is saying. I agree with Councillor Grotek. I've indeed seconded the proposal. I was going to make a similar proposal myself. I'm not remotely comfortable with the prospect of this council at the 11th hour rushing through, in my opinion, a monumentous decision that's going to have such a huge impact on the new authority. I think it's totally appropriate for the new council to make this decision. I don't think the arguments that we're being presented with in this paper stack up currently. I don't think we've been presented with a financial reason for pushing it through today. Well, we've been told that it will make a saving, but we're also being told that we've also been told that we don't know what the financial implications will be. We've been told that the reduced number of members in the new council will make it impossible for us to function in the current format, and yet we've been functioning with a reduced number of members for years. So that argument doesn't stack up, in my opinion.
I think impossible is too strong a word. It's to make it easier, I think, as opposed to impossible.
My personal opinion is that those justifications for pushing it through today do not stack up. I think a lot of work has gone into it, a lot of hard work, and I genuinely appreciate that. And I think there's a lot of good ideas in there, but I think there are some bad ideas, and I think it needs more work, and that work should be undertaken as soon as available opportunity after the election in May.
Chair of Council isn't here at the moment. She's obviously, but I'm very aware of her views on this, and her view on this is essentially if it goes to the new council, it'll be 3 years before anything happens, because we are in the whole world the experts on what the best way of running the council, and you're one of them, Gareth. So that's fine. So you've made your point, but I don't actually think that the new council will be equipped to do this for a considerable amount of time, and then they could well be in the same situation in 3.5 years' time, not being able to put it forward because they think the new council should do it. I'm possibly exaggerating there, but Councillor Guy.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm in full support of Councillor Grotek for what she said. On page 6, 1.11, I just think it's worth pointing out. It's in accordance with the statutory instrument that was imposed on us in 2010 and not the IFCA constitution. And also on page 3 it states for the IFCA a minimum of 3 councillors, it's a maximum of 3 councillors, just for the record.
Absolutely, thank you for that. This doesn't impact on IFCA in any way, shape or form, which is perhaps why it's not been looked at in the same amount of detail.
My point is, it's misreported in this report.
Yes, I accept that, but it would not impact on IFCA in any way, shape, or form. Councillor Saville.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm afraid I'm going to disagree with all my fellow members who have already spoken on this debate today. Firstly, I would like to ask Mr. Williams a question about a new council coming in and then looking at this straight away. I presumably would think they would have far more important things that they need to familiarise themselves with initially: finance training, standards training, licensing training, training on the work of community services and the children's services. I think there is an awful lot of priorities for any new member to join when they join the authority. Secondly, I would like to say I think this proposal is one way of not disenfranchising the off-islands. We are more than, I guess we are 99.9% sure that what the Boundary Commission has suggested will actually be imposed. Therefore, each off-island will have represented by one member. And I think you cannot expect them, or they have to have a right to have a presence on every committee if it stays the same throughout the council. Therefore, they could be a whole area of the council services totally unaware of what is going on, except for the minutes that come to full council on a quarterly basis. So, you know, I represent an off-island who are really against the reduction of off-island councillors to one, but I think I do support this because it does not disenfranchise off-islands. And also, what is wrong with all members of council taking all decisions? What can possibly be negative about that? Obviously, there is considerable work to do around standing orders, terms of reference, etc., etc. But this isn't a paper that's come forward in haste. We started talking about this last October, December time. We've had several meetings about it. And so I don't think it's just been pulled together and presented. I think there has been a lot of debate in the DPP panels, and I would recommend it to members in many ways, Chairman, and I might come back to talk.
I thoroughly agree with Councillor Saville. I think, as she says, 99% sure that we are only going to end up with one councillor on the off islands, and I think it's too much for them to sit on every single committee as we have now. There's a lot of work gone into this, and I think it's a good basis to start off the new council with. It can always be reviewed during the next council, but I fully support it.
Thank you, Chairman. I respect Councillor Saville's comments and she's entitled to her opinion. However, I don't think it's appropriate to suggest that the public who will elect the new council are not capable of electing people who are capable of doing the job once they're elected. Then, if the public elects them, it's their responsibility to address all of the issues, including this one. That's my opinion. And I will put my faith in the new council, whether I'm on it or not.
It's nice to know there is some faith still. Councillor Coombs.
As the newest councillor to the table, the current structure has been difficult to navigate. The council has got a lot of very important business to be dealing with after the elections. So certainly the DPP process has been a good process and well considered. It's certainly not been just sort of thrown together. So I very much endorse and support Councillor Saville, Councillor Mumford's position. Certainly as a new councillor, the last thing I would want to have been thrown in my lap is right now go away and reorganise the whole council structure. I'd rather be presented with something clear and transparent. And certainly from my perspective, all members being out much more on a full council approach to things certainly seems a much more transparent and much more workable way of doing things.
Yes, and of course it is, as all things are, subject to review. And I think it's Councillor Lady Bartley. Is. I'm dying to say that.
I like hearing it. I'd like to just speak very much from the point of view of an off-island councillor of many years and very much a nuts and bolts councillor. I understand the reasoning behind the proposals, but I do believe that in practical terms, we may not in future see the outcomes that we have through the old committee structure. I'll give you one example. Richard and I worked very closely and very hard on achieving social housing for the off island. And it involved trips away, endless hours of things, because we wanted something practical for our communities. And it's been of enormous benefit. How is that sort of project going to happen under the new structure? People aren't going to have the time. Is it all going to be down to the chairman of the council? It won't happen. Those sort of very detailed, constructive thing outcomes will be sacrificed, I believe, and I don't support the proposals. I do support Councillor Gottick, was it?
Oh, yeah, well, thank you.
Ask for review, and I think that the new council, really, even if it's time limited, be involved to a certain degree with the forthcoming formula for decision making.
Well, as far as my understanding is, they would be, because it's all subject to review. However, there is a lead member for place and a lead member for people who would be in part responsible for the social housing. And it, what would be incumbent on current chairs would be incumbent on them to do. Councillor Daly.
Thank you, Chairman. While it's tempting to go for this much neater solution involving less work to approve the new member structure by the present council, it seems high-handed and arrogant for the retiring council to impose a structure on the new one without having had a say in it. It would also seem more democratic for the new council to have alternatives to choose from. Thus, it would seem best to have item one on their business, that they decide on the structure for the new council. It's very rare for me to disagree with Councillor Saville, in fact, almost unknown, but I do on this occasion because I think we're not in a position to tell them what to do. So I shall be supporting the resolution of Councillors Grosick and O'Neill. In addition to all that, I find there's several weaknesses in this report. The appointment to outside bodies doesn't seem to have been properly considered. People to be appointed to sit on some role in the council. At the moment they attend a certain committee. What committees are they going to attend if they're not there? So what meetings should they attend? We've seen no standing orders for this committee, and I've asked for them several times. I've always been promised they're about to drop in my lap, but they never have. It might be possible to have a structure where you have the basic structure there, but I think in addition to that, and taking up what Marion said, that you might need temporary committees to deal with a particular subject, particularly on the North Island. The scrutiny in this document seems to be very weak. It doesn't seem to be dealt with at all. It says in a vague way there will be some scrutiny. That needs to be set down, particularly as we've been told that's a great weakness of this council by the LGA. We do need a proper structure for scrutiny. And after all the trauma we've gone through in the last year with the financial problems, I do think we need a much stronger responsibility for finances. I think the chief executive should be more involved. Previous one always was. And we need to have some proper look so we don't go down these dark roads that we've had to go through in the last year. So I should be supporting Councillors Grosick and O'Neill.
Chairman, is it appropriate for me now?
Can we all put our lights off? That's just me, isn't it? I'll put my light off.
I was just going to say, would it be helpful, because I was aware Councillor Saville asked me a question and I haven't had a chance to come back on it yet. Would that be helpful? Hello?
Yeah, we all have our mics off, yes.
Okay, this issue about whether it's right for the existing administration to put in place something for the new administration or to leave it to the new administration, I think it's fair to say in my experience that, and having been in local government for a long time, that both County Council and Cornwall Council always reviewed its constitution towards the end of its four-year cycle with a view to putting something in place on the basis of its learning. And I think there is some element of truth in what Councillor Saville said, that actually, if you're going to get, who knows, but if you're going to, I know that one or two of you are not, definitely not standing, so you're going to have some new members. I think the idea of a new council coming with, well, this is the existing, but we're not sure about it, and this is some proposals to change, I think the likelihood is it will take some time to implement. So I don't think it, for the last speaker, I don't think it is arrogant. I think actually what it is the members saying, over our experience for the last 4 years, we either, we feel it's worth doing a change and this is the change that we're going to do, or it's perfectly acceptable for you to put it on hold and to give it to the new administration, but I don't think it's arrogant, and I would say that generally speaking, existing administrations do review, as we are doing currently in readiness for our elections, we will put in a new governance structure and tidy up the constitution. Two further things I probably would say, which I hope will be helpful. The first one is that it is possible So the first thing is that we will do an awful lot of work. I'm expecting the Democratic Processes Panel to be meeting at least once between now and May, and hopefully maybe even twice, but certainly once, to certainly consider some of the detail and the documents that will come forward in May. So it won't be a simply dropping a whole lot of new stuff in relation to your new constitution and governance in May. It will go to the DPP first. But another thing I think which is really important is, you know, ironically, if you do agree to the new system and new processes being recommended, you are having council meetings every month, which for me, one of the important things about that is, you know, that you set up, or if you vote for these proposals and endorse it in May, then you set up what you believe to be right. If things aren't covered, or things for the new administration they want to change or tweak or whatever, you know, you've got the benefit of the fact that the new council is meeting on a monthly basis and will have that opportunity to do that. So as I said when I came over in last month, I would almost be assuming that certainly for the early months or even longer than that, you'd almost have a standing item on your council, which would be constitution and governance matters. And if nothing needed changing, it was all working fine, all well and good, but if anything needed to be tweaked or changed, you can do it fairly quickly. So that's one of the advantages of, you know, it's not a question of agreeing today, getting the documentation in May, and then you know, forget about it. We have, of course, under Recommendation 6, provided for review, but my view is that effectively, because you've got monthly council meetings, you'll be constantly reviewing the governance, and that for me is a mark of a mature authority, that effectively the council does constantly review its governance and constitution and makes it work for it, rather than, you know, what often happens is councils set up constitutions and they're almost frightened to change it ever, and they stay in place for 4 years, 5 years, and clearly don't meet the needs of the council. So I think that's an important point to make.
Thank you, Richard. I would just a couple, because I can't really stay neutral on this one, because I didn't intend to be neutral when I came into the meeting, and unfortunately Amanda's disappeared. Gordon, with respect to what you said regarding democracy, I don't think it sacrifices democracy. This immensely enhances democratic process, because all members have input on all decisions. And regarding what Colin said regarding scrutiny, as lead member for scrutiny, I am very happy to say we are borderline useless at scrutiny. We do a terrible job, and I think there are a lot, and the scrutiny panel and the lead member for scrutiny, with ongoing pre, post and scrutiny for every decision, is going to enhance the process, particularly with a lead member whose role is primarily scrutiny. We need to get scrutiny sorted out in this council for a number of reasons, which some have come up today and have certainly come up in recent meetings. So I think that my main reason to support this is because of scrutiny. I don't think the rest of it will make a huge material difference to the council. It will just make it in some ways easier, but scrutiny is what we need to sort out, and this is a method to do it. Councillor O'Neill.
Thank you, Chairman. A couple of comments. First of all, I want to make it abundantly clear to everybody that I'm not against change. And just because I'm supporting Councillor Grotek's proposal that doesn't support this document in its current format doesn't mean that I don't agree with some of Councillor Saville's comments. I'm all for equal rights to all members, democracy. Mm. Beautiful, wonderful. Let's have it. Bring it on. I don't have any problem with that. I don't have any problem with making anything easier, better, streamlined for off-island councillors. I have no problem with that at all. I've told you what my problem is with this current document, but I just want to make another comment, and that's this. I've heard the argument presented today that potentially the new council won't be capable of dealing with this issue, or, you know, it's been referred to by a number of members. But my view is this. When I was fortunate enough to be elected to this authority, it took me a while to find my feet, and I learned a lot from members who had spent a number of years on the council, including Councillor Saville. And I was very fortunate enough to benefit from their knowledge and expertise and experience. Now, my concern is that the danger, potentially, I see, is that a completely new system for a completely new council is the blind leading the blind. Because everybody will turn to the person next to them and say, how does this normally work? And the answer will be, I don't know, we've never done it before. And I don't think that's a good way forward.
Yes, Chairman.
Councillor Bilsborough.
The devil is in the detail. I agree with Councillor Saville, I'm sure we all do, that the North Islanders ought to be given the opportunity to vote on every committee, and we have, and we now have, or we will have four committees. So I don't think, in supporting the proposal, that the off islands are going to suffer. So, you know, it's a small point, but a vital point for the off islands. All I say is, the devil is in the detail, but we must not say to the new council, this is what it's going to be. Why are we frightened to let them discuss it?
Councillor Savile, I believe.
Chairman, they will discuss it.
Okay,
they will review it, as recommendation 6 actually says. So they will have an opportunity to review it. We've just heard Mr. Williams explain very clearly that actually this kind of review often takes place at the end of one session of council rather than referring it to a new council. I think we also have to bear in mind that we have all approved today £25,000 saving within the governance and membership of the authority. So, you know, we have that to deliver whatever way forward, and the sooner that we can start delivering it, the better. You yourself, Chairman, have mentioned scrutiny. This is something that this council, I mean, I've been around a few years, has not done very well, and in fact hasn't legally had to do. But I think we would all also agree that it would, and remember instances when thorough scrutiny would have achieved better outcomes for our community. So I would urge members to really think about the scrutiny role of this authority, because I think it is quite exciting going forward. I think it is essential going forward, with it living within the financial constraints that we currently have. I think it is really important that, and we can delay. And unless we start implementing something, we haven't got anything to review. If we start implementing it and it goes, you know, it's not quite as we wanted, it can be reviewed by the incoming council chairman. And maybe members think, as I'm not standing again, that I am being arrogant, that, you know, supporting this documentation. But, Chairman, you know, I'm thinking that for a council, this is the way forward. We have changed governance more than once in the time that I've been on the council, after much thought, and each time, you know, it has been successful. So I would, you know, urge members to support this.
Councillor Peacock.
Yeah, well, I'm betwixt and between. I wholly support monthly meetings for everyone to join in all the committees, because I think one of the problems of being an off-island member and the problems of getting to meetings, if you're St Mary's councillor, you can come and you can sit in a meeting with no problem. You just leave your house, you come, sit down for an hour or so, and go home. If there is a particular problem, I have a problem with several things. I have a problem with waste. I have a problem with sea defences. I have a great problem with sea defences. But I'm not sitting on that committee. Now, in order to get to the committee that discusses these things, you've got to find out when it's going to be discussed, and also you've got to give up, if it's in the winter, half a day at least to come down and sit in on a committee. I think if you are discussing everything in one meeting, and let's face it, if you're having a meeting once a month, you're not going to cover everything in that month, because you've got another meeting coming up the following month. And I think you're going to know when that meeting is, and I think that is a better innovation than what we have now. We've had times of meeting changed. You plan to come to a meeting, and then you get a message saying, sorry, that has been deferred to another date. And it makes it all the more difficult. The other difficulty from an off-island is that the work level for one council, I know Councillor Bennett, or whatever, has coped very well on Briar with there being one councillor. But I think, as I see it from St Agnes, it is very difficult to represent your community on all committees and to know what's going on if you're just the one councillor. So in that respect, I do go ahead with this. But on another respect, looking at some of the work, I think, like having lead members with no backup, I think the lead member should certainly have a backup. I think having a lead member with no backup at all is very difficult, and I think that should have a backup. And I think maybe when it's gone into, you're not going to save the money that you think you're going to save. But I am really between, I think there should be more, I say, as Gordon said, the devil is in the detail, and some of the detail is missing.
Yes, thank you for that. I don't. Cost is not the driving force behind this, the change in governments. The savings came about after the process. It's not the be-all and end-all in this. And regarding what you said, regarding deferring decisions, well, it's actually, I agree with you, it's much easier to defer a decision if you know you're going to come back to it in 4 weeks rather than 3.5 months or sometimes longer. So that's really, really useful. It does enable, if you like, the management process to work much more effectively. Councillor Nullums.
Thank you, Chairman.
Who was it? Sorry, it was no. Councillor Grotting. Pardon me. Grotting. Sorry.
Councillor Nellums hasn't spoken yet, so I'll defer to him first, Chairman.
Thank you.
How kind, thank you. I've not been able to come to any of the meetings at all for various reasons, mostly just not available, but I have been following the paperwork, and I found it all moving in the right direction, particularly the recommendations. They seem sensible, they seem solid. There's the monthly meeting feeling, but then I have to say I've been swayed very strongly by Councillor O'Neill and Councillor Barclay, and very much Councillor Peacock's sort of views on how you see it. And so I came with the idea of supporting it, and I think I still will support it because I like the fact that, as Richard Williams says, that all of this can be reviewed on a regular basis. And I think that's, for me, the main thing. The new council can look at how these things are addressed. I've had various conversations with other councillors before the meeting, and I think all of these problems, as they seem to be, can be discussed and moved in the right direction. So I will be mindful to support this.
And also, there are no terms of reference set at the moment. I mean, this is an outline which will be processed, and certainly I do take your point regarding lead members needing support, and there's no reason why there could not be deputy lead members if the new council chooses to have them. Again, it's a fluid process, and this isn't perfect by any means, and it will never be perfect. And I'm sure in 5 or 6 years' time, if we put this through now, it will be thrown out, and something new will come in. This is what happens. Councillor O'Neill.
Councillor.
Sorry, I'm not trying to shut you up, Fran. Carry on.
Thank you, Chairman. I've listened carefully to colleagues, including the robust support from the Chair. And obviously, sometimes a Chair is more neutral, but on this occasion, since it's our working arrangements, I accept that it is legitimate that you put forward quite strongly your view. However, the scrutiny aspect actually is indicative of my real concern about the whole process, because I want more fine detail. There's a lot of good in this report, and there's a lot that I have real reservations about. And all I am saying is, at this moment in time, I do not think we have enough fine detail to move forward with confidence and support, even in principle, the current suggestion, because it's not wide enough. Scrutiny may well be delivered, as is suggested in this report. The Children's Committee and the Community Services Committee may well be found to work perfectly effectively in the suggested format that is here. But there may be also another format that may be equally good, and I don't think we've yet explored in enough detail enough of the ways in which we could move forward. The Democratic Processes Panel is quite a small panel, albeit other people were invited to it. but I still think the time frame, there was only brief mention at the October meeting, then a meeting at the beginning of December, and then a very fast trajectory to where we are now. I still don't think we've got enough fine detail. I am not saying that there are not good points in this, but my proposal stands.
Yes, thank you for that. But however, I mean, I think Councillor Saville said this to me at the end of the last meeting. We could be talking about this until November or next November, and we will still come up with the same conclusions. I do think any DPP panel, even with the new
council... Respectfully, Chairman, we might not be talking about it in November because we might not get elected.
That's... Well, when I say we, I'm talking about members. I'm not talking about us as specific members. So, but, I mean, I do think that is the case. I think further discussion on this, we're broadly going to come up with the same thing, unless you get a new council... And the new council are not... I'm not saying they're thick, I'm not saying they're going to be stupid, I'm saying they're not actually, they will not have the knowledge base to make this decision for at least a couple of years. And that's fine, if you wish to run with it, I have no issue with that. But I don't think anybody was insulting this amorphous new council in the earlier stages of the meeting.
With respect, you've got a proposal and a seconder.
Yes, I know, so now I think we should probably...
Can we have a recording? I'm proposing formally, in standing orders, that the vote is recorded.
Can I just say, before we take the vote, Chairman, just one last comment. You're absolutely right. This is a fluid process. This is, I think Councillor Grottet referred to it as a work in progress. I'm not against everything in this document, but I don't think it's ready. And I hear alarm bells ringing when people tell me I have to make that decision today. Why do I? Why can't it wait until the new council in May?
Well, I mean, this is...
Well, I mean, I know what your answer to that. It was a rhetorical question, Chairman, but you know my views.
Yeah, but this is what council is for, to make these decisions, and this is what happens. Councillor Billsborough... Oh, sorry, Councillor Mumford.
I would just like to say that I do think that this is a very good basis in which to start the new council.
Yeah, absolutely.
Whether any of us are elected or not, and... There would be reviews right the way through if something wasn't working or if a lead member decided that they wanted someone to back them up, then that could be done. But I do think we should move forward with this to start this off. There is still time for the Democratic Process Panel to meet again before the elections, and I think the officers have done an awful lot of work on this, and I really would urge members to go forward with it.
Just before we go to the vote on the first proposal, would anybody like to propose accepting what we have as such?
I will.
Okay, that's okay. So we now have two proposals.
We have to,
well, I realise that. Councillor Grottet.
Excuse me, Councillor Billsborough's proposal...
And also Councillor Billsborough has proposed that we could...
I'm happy to second Councillor Billsborough's proposal for a report.
All right, I think... should we do the uncontentious vote first? Should we have a recorded vote? All those in favour of a recorded vote? Against? Abstentions? So it looks like we do have a recorded vote. Councillor O'Neill.
Thank you again, Chairman. Just another comment. I'm sure they'll keep coming. But I agree with Councillor Mumford's comment that this is a good place to start. It's not necessarily the best place to finish, which is why I think it should go immediately to the first meeting of the DPP, of the new council, and say to them, look, this is where we've got to. Any ideas? Have an opinion. Have an input.
Councillor O'Neill, if this was the finish, I would completely agree with you. But it's not. It's an ongoing process which will be reviewed, I'm sure, at great length over the coming 4, 8, 12 years. Councillor, I'm tempted to say whatever. Councillor Lady Barclay.
Sorry. I agree with Councillor O'Neill and Councillor Mumford that it's a good starting position. But I do think the actual proposals as laid out make me slightly nervous. The review is sort of a little bit nebulous, and I would like to see something far more concrete and say, put an onus on the new council and say, under point six, that members review the revised governance arrangements after the 6 months, which would bring us like to the year end. And I think that is time enough to give impetus and also to come up with some mitigating factors. You know, the clarification of the roles of the members, the recording of meetings, which in fact at the moment is pretty meaningless. When you read the minutes, you do not get a good understanding of what was transacted. The possibility of an off-island councillor, if they're left as a single person, to pair up with a St Mary's buddy, that is more of a formal arrangement, so that there is support in the case of absence. And just another point, when it comes to the saving in finances, the 25,000 that Councillor Saville is keen to point out, in fact, that will disappear very quickly in the level of training required for the new council on these issues.
I think training is essential, irrespective of what format the council takes. I think, Bob, you have your mic on?
I do. Thank you, Chair. Just to recap on a few points that may be useful, and I take on board all the comments that have been made around the table today, including specifically that made by Councillor Guy regarding IFCA. This is very much a paper looking at the intention is for a managed process going forward. So the first point, as we have kind of legal assurance on, is the structure. That's the concrete starting point. So that's really what we're being asked to, what the first recommendation's asking for. In terms of scrutiny and other processes, those are in development. We need that structure agreed to further develop those scrutiny processes. There's a lot of work being done on those in the background. That level of detail is there. It's just more appropriate to bring that towards the May Council, when we will also have all these documents, like the standing orders, scheme of delegation, terms of reference, all in place, so that everybody in the new council, whether it's everybody completely new members or not, have that as a starting point. Everybody is on the same page. They all receive training for which there's an allocated budget. And then from that point forward, then they're continuing to make those kind of review and management decisions on the new structure. So that's the picture. So we're really, the main has been recommendation one is about agreeing the structure, and that's your concrete starting point. In terms of the timing, my understanding is that the recommended change time is a meeting of full council before annual council. And I think Richard Williams has made reference to that as well. If Richard wants to make any further comment, I'm sure he'd be willing to. But that's just, I wanted to kind of make those few points about the document. And this was under the direction of the DPP to go forward and produce a model for a streamlined committee system, which we've had and which members are having a good and thorough discussion of today. Thank you.
Yes, much like Councillor Lellums, I'm fairly torn on this issue, although I think I'm going to come down on the opposite side. I think one of the troubles we have here is that we are making assumptions on what the life situations and other commitments may be for new councillors. We don't know the position they'll be in, their commitments to their own work, families and other such things, and I think it's very important that whomever is elected to come onto this council in the future has a chance to have their own input into the way they feel we ought to operate. So for that reason alone, I'm going to probably come down on the side of Councillor Grotek and Councillor O'Neill. I'm also quite amused by the comment in 2.2 that the new council will help increase public perception of the council as a stable organisation. I've got a very sure feeling that we need to go an awful lot further than this document to increase the public perception of this as a stable organisation. But I suppose that will very much be down to the new council to get right.
Councillor McCarthy.
Yes, thank you. I'm torn on this decision as well. I mean, like various other councillors, I'm afraid I shan't be standing next time round, and I kind of feel guilty about actually doing something that actually is going to not affect my role, having, you know, because I'm not going to be here. But having said that, I find the fact that we've lost a member on the off-islands, each of the off-islands, you know, the off-island representation has been reduced by 50%, and I'm so angry about that, and I express my feelings to the Boundary Commission, and I don't think they took any notice. I think it was a done deal from day one. And I therefore think that we have got to look radically, whether I agree with it or not, at the future, and I think this is a good start, and that's where I get stuck, because have we actually got to the end of the race? I mean, I think I will probably vote for this, unless I hear other arguments to the contrary, but feeling slightly guilty because it's not going to affect me. I'm going to be grinning at everybody else from the public benches. I'm slightly perplexed about how we should go forward, but on balance, I think I will support this, bearing in mind the new authority and the new council will be perfectly free to decide what it wants to do anyway, that it's going to be a meeting every month.
Right, thank you, Richard. I think we need to draw this to a conclusion fairly soon. Obviously, Councillor Mumford and Councillor Saville, and any other members who haven't said anything on this, I think would be, if they wish to make an input. But Councillor, should I go to you first, Robert?
Because
you
have just like
okay, Councillor Mumford, then go on.
Sorry.
Okay.
I'd just like to say that Councillor McCarthy and Councillor Saville are the most experienced councillors at the moment.
I think Councillor Lady
Barnes. I'm sorry, Councillor Bennett.
And Councillor.
Sorry.
Okay, Councillor. And Sir Colin.
Yes, I'm talking about the ones that are who are supporting this. And
well qualified.
I think both of them have put it from the off-islands view, of which so do I, because I think that when you've got just one councillor on the off-islands, for them to sit on every single committee is too much. And I think this way is far better, and I think, as I've said before, it's a good basis to start with, and there's a lot of work that can be done before the next council sits, and as it says at the bottom, it can be reviewed at any time.
Councillor Saville, and then Councillor...
Chairman, can I just say, earlier in this meeting, we took some quite serious decisions around finances.
Yes.
That nobody wanted to shelve to the next council. We took those decisions because they needed to be taken. And we are still councillors, and also we have heard... and I'd like to hear from him again, just before you wind up, if you may, Chairman, Mr. Williams, for a final word. So we have taken decisions, and if we remain with the current committee system, I think you will need 14 chairmen and vice chairmen of committees, and you're only going to have 16 members. So you're going to have no backbenchers. Currently, some members have more responsibilities than they possibly want. For instance, I chair three committees. I would rather not be chairing three committees. Councillor Mrs. Grotick, to her, I hold her in high respect. She is actually the lead member for adults and for children's services, two very responsible jobs. And I think we must bear in mind the actual working practices with a limited number of members. Obviously, you can say we've been working with 17, we've been, et cetera, et cetera. But actually, a lot of the work has been actually confined to, a few councillors, which isn't actually democratically correct for our community or for the council.
Councillor Dorian Smith.
Thank you, Chairman. I haven't said anything so far on this because I'm rather torn as well from the off-island point of view. I think the new system will put a great deal of weight on the individual. And probably the fundamental issue here is really that the loss of the two off-island councillors is going to prove very, very difficult to manage for anybody. I have a wider anxiety, which of course is how this will be understood publicly and whether in fact this is going to be a disincentive for people to put themselves forward for election. Because for an employed person, we're saying at least 12 full days a month during a weekday. Now, that requires the employer to be generous, and also for a self-employed person, that also means they're going to have to give up a chunk of their work, and it may well turn out to be more than 12 full days a year, when you think that most people have a holiday entitlement of the region of 20 full days. You know, it's marching up on the same sort of level. So that gives me some anxiety. But then I know that that has been discussed, and I've had the opportunity to attend some of the meetings, and I haven't done so. So I can't really complain at this stage about the content. I think item 6 is very important, that any new council must review very carefully what is proposed. But I will support Councillor Saville on the basis of her great wisdom and experience. because I think
very dangerous.
I think you've nailed it, Christine. I do think that you know, we've got to make a change, actually, given our reduction in numbers, and I think this change looks good. If it proves to be otherwise, the council of the time will have to change what's now proposed. But I think in terms of in the round, and whilst I also support the other argument, I personally would support the proposal.
Can I just take Councillor Grotic, and hopefully that will be it. And
Thank you, Chairman. Very quickly, can I just clarify, colleagues, you're not actually voting to retain the status quo, which is what seems to have been suggested. You're not voting between retaining the status quo and this new reported suggestion. You're actually voting to delay and into the calendar of the new council further work based on this document.
I think we are voting for the status quo because it will just go forward as is
now. You may well be in the immediately after the election. I agree with you, Chair. You will just move forward with the existing committee structure, which indeed we worked with perfectly happily with 17 councillors for quite a while. But what I'm saying is, all I am saying is that this is a work in progress, and that as soon as is practically possible, more work will be done so that the system, whatever it is, will be presented to council in a more robust form.
James.
Well, I was about to say, I am pleased that obviously the view of two exceptionally experienced councillors on the other side of the argument is not quite so relevant. But more importantly, I think oddly, Councillor Dorian Smith's comments I agree with wholeheartedly. The trouble is it actually reinforces my opinion to actually stick with it and allow the people who are coming on to choose their own way of working. Oddly, Councillor Dorian Smith obviously wants to support the document, but what he actually said for me is a really strong argument to allow those that are coming onto this council to understand their own life circumstances, as I said previously, and to have some input into the way that they sit and work with this council.
Yes, Chairman, I agree with Councillor Francis and Councillor Grotic. All I can say is, very modestly, in view of experience, my experience covers two councillors going back to 1970. So I can speak with some authority on this. In St Albans, the vast majority of the meetings were in the evening.
Can you be very brief?
Yeah, my final comment, I promise, Chairman. And that's, I can't even really remember what it was now. That's probably a good way to end it, isn't it? Referring to Councillor Saville's comments again. I know. Referring to Councillor Saville's comments about we've made other decisions in this meeting today. Absolutely we have, I think in your own words, because we had to make those decisions. Absolutely. And this is a decision we don't have to make today.
I'll ask Mr. Williams to come in for a second, but I don't wish anybody to get hung up about times and meetings. Members will have less meetings to attend under the new system than they have now, and there's no reason to think it's going to be on a Wednesday morning. It could be on a Saturday, and certainly in the summer, I imagine it will be in the evening. I mean, that is down to the chair of committees, or the chair of council in this instance. However, could I ask Richard to come in back in again, if he has any final comments, and then we can take this to a vote.
So thank you very much, Chairman. And I think that's been an extremely good debate. And can I say that I fully respect the views of all members on both sides of this particular argument. And as I said at the beginning, of course, both votes are possible. It's interesting for me as monitoring officer, what would I advise you, or what would I be thinking that I would want the new administration to have? And I guess it's the choice between an administration that's reviewed and feels that there are reasons to change, that the status quo, because of the principles set out, doesn't quite work, and there's a new approach, and this is the new approach we've come up with, we think will work, we've put the supporting documents in and the supporting process in to make it work, but you have the opportunity to review, and you have the opportunity on a month-by-month basis to tweak, and then a formal review, and just to pick up on Councillor Lady Barclay's point, I would probably say that after 6 months, and if members want to put that in to give greater security about that, I think the review, at least 6 months is needed to bed in, but I think it's quite right that maybe recommendation 6 is slightly modified to say that the review starts after 6 months. I think a suggestion around that is quite sensible. So that's on the one hand. On the other hand, it's about saying, well, a lot of work has been done. We don't think it works. And over to you, new members. Here we are where we've reached. This is the point we've reached. We think some good stuff in here, but we think it's a bit too early, and we want you to take a further look. And I think I have to say, as monitoring officer, if I was going one side or the other of those two proposals, I'd go for the former, because I think it's right for the existing council. I don't think it's, as I said earlier, I don't think you're being arrogant. I think it's quite right to review where you've got, to look at what you're facing in terms of the reduced number of members and the principles that you've done. I think the Democratic Process Panel have looked at this carefully, and it seemed when I was there in September that the Democratic Process Panel, by a reasonable majority, were supporting these proposals. Please be reassured that we will provide the level of training necessary. We will also make sure that all the documents are there, particularly scrutiny. We've got a lot of experience in scrutiny here. We will draft some scrutiny procedure rules for the Democratic Processes Panel to look at and consider prior to coming back to full council. So I would say, I understand the arguments are finely balanced, but as your monitoring officer, I would favour the fact that this has gone through a fairly detailed process. You're doing what you think is best to address some of the deficiencies that exist in the current system and some of the concerns that are going to come through from the Boundary Commission decision. You're doing your best to put the council in a good position, but you're not saying, obviously you won't have your power. The council can change what feel it doesn't work, can change direction if it feels to do that, but I think it's a responsible council that puts a process in place that it feels will work and feels addresses some of the issues around the status quo. I think that's all I'd say, Chairman.
Thank you very much. Now, I think we have two proposals on the table. The first one, which was for a deferment, essentially, to the decision made to the new council. Have we got... Would you like to just give us the wording again to remind
us? Yes, indeed. Yes. Thank you, Chairman. My proposal is that the newly elected council be recommended to investigate further and decide their preferred working structure, aided by the Democratic Processes Panel and this report. And we have a recorded vote.
Okay, in that case, do we have to do this in the same way as previously, or can you just... it's not a roll call, so those in favour. Against? Eight. So it looks like we have done nothing. Okay. I believe that concludes the meeting. Pardon? We have democratically done nothing, absolutely, which is correct. Thank you very much, Richard. And Andy, if you're still there, and survived. Thank you very much for your input, and thank you. So thank you very much.
Don't want to do further? No, I know.
Richard, if you're still there, I don't know if you heard that. Thank you very much. And
Are you going to do the further item, Chairman?
I'm sorry, can you just... A bit of quiet a sec. Sorry, Richard.
I thought there was an item on purdah, Chairman.
I'm sorry. It's not finished yet. Richard, no, we're not...
No,
we don't. That was just for information.
Thank you very much, Chairman.
All right, thank you very much. Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye now. Bye-bye.